Hello, and thanks for joining us on In The Zone, our series of interviews from the Middle East Treaty Organization, NATO, digging underneath the debates around banning weapons of mass destruction from the region. I'm your co-host, Anahita.
And I'm Paul.
Today we're talking to Anton Khlopkov, who's director of the Center for Energy and Security Studies in Moscow, and has an extensive network within the city and beyond. Anton and I go back some years. I think we first met in Iran on several visits to that country in order to talk energy issues, proliferation issues. And Anton has good knowledge of not only the Russian perspective, but also across the region. He featured within a recent panel discussion hosted by METO. That's why we've asked him on to talk about the WMD free zone. So, Anton, it's good to have you on board. What is it that you think is most important to get across about the zone and how important it is to the future of non-proliferation within the region?
First of all, Paul and Anahita, thank you for inviting. Pleasure to join you. First, again, we should note that the zone in the Middle East, this is a long-term goal. I personally don't see any chance to reach this goal quickly. But if we are serious about stability and security in the region, we should start dialogue and we should start moving in that direction. And I personally see what is going on in Vienna right now, so-called negotiations on U.S. return to the JCPOA and Iran return to the full compliance. If those negotiations succeed, which I hope will be the case very much, if those negotiations will succeed, I think it could contribute to some first positive developments with regard to establishing the zone in the region.
Over the last 10 years, we've seen a lot of up and down around the zone and dashed hopes, which have been risen, particularly 10 years ago. From your perspective, I mean, you've been involved in this for a good two or three decades. From your perspective, what's been the sense in Moscow of this? I mean, it must be incredibly frustrating. I mean, Russia is one of the three depository states, and it's had to handle quite a lot of change in policy coming out of Washington. What's your reading of all of that?
Well, Russia is one of three depositories of NPT for sure, and my impression that Russian officials and also think tanks were quite active to promote the idea, to provide a platform for the dialogue. But what is critically important in this regard, that all major players, stakeholders, countries of the region should be involved in this dialogue if we are serious about possible progress. And unfortunately, it was not the case, including during the recent months. So I think if we speak about what should be the priority for the upcoming year or so, try to engage all major capitals in the region into the dialogue. And here, nuclear weapon states, and including the depositories of NPT, including Russia, could play their important role. It is not an easy issue. And as I mentioned, a miracle will not happen. The zone will not be established tomorrow. But as experience of some other regions says us, I mean, it's doable. And we should also keep in mind that, unfortunately, the Middle East is the region where WMDs, and especially chemical weapons, were used on a number of cases in the past. So this is a real threat.
I was wondering, as you mentioned, it's not going to be an overnight miracle. And there are probably a lot of things that are stopping us from being able to just very easily establish a WMD-free zone in the Middle East. What would you consider are some of the biggest obstacles that we have to consider?
Already mentioned no channels of the regular dialogue, lack of trust And I mean, we should think about confidence building measures, what could be done, and nuclear field, peaceful nuclear cooperation, safety issues, some joint research projects are the areas where we could invest our time, our experience, and our diplomatic capital. We do have some examples in the region, not many, but again, I would like to return to the GCPOA. If it is fully restored, I think it could create additional opportunities for some confidence building measures in the nuclear field among the countries of the region.
Also, I was quite interested maybe to ask, with regards to this entire process, what kind of overlapping interest do you see that the US, for example, and Russia might have to encourage them to be able to facilitate all of these measures that you have suggested taking to be able to tackle some of these obstacles?
Probably this is not an area where Russia and US could start cooperation very quickly, because the disagreements are quite significant. If we speak about the region in general, on Syria, on many other places in the region, so probably we could identify some narrow issues like nuclear, again, safety, nuclear non-proliferation, where I do believe we have shared interest between Moscow and Washington. And if our governments are pragmatic enough so they can shield this cooperation from those disagreements, which we have or might have on other issues. There are some examples when actually this approach worked in the past, including the GCPOA negotiations in 2014, 2015, but sometimes we failed due to to cooperate efficiently due to disagreements on other issues. And again, just to conclude with the positive experience, good experience, removal and destruction of declared chemical weapons from Syria. I do think it was a success story, and we were quite pragmatic to cooperate on that issue, despite of our disagreements on the future of the Syrian government, on the future of our cooperation in Ukraine and other places. So we should try to identify narrow areas in the region where we can cooperate, and I do think we have those areas.
Anton, I wonder if we could just change tack for a second. I mentioned earlier that we met in Iran some years back. I think it was a conference focused on the Iranian objectives of promoting nuclear disarmament. What was it that got you first interested in this part of the world? Because you're probably the, if not one, certainly one of the leading experts within Moscow focused on the Middle East. What is it that interested you?
I think the answer is really simple. My master degree thesis in the university, the Moscow Engineering Physics Institute or MEFI University, war on Iran nuclear program more than 20 years ago. This is actually how it started. And since then, I follow, first of all, Iran nuclear file, and since other countries of the region either possess nuclear capability like Israel or have interest to develop nuclear energy programs like Turkey, like Egypt, like some others. So my area of interest have been expanded. But all this started in the university more than 20 years ago.
And over these 20-odd years that you've been involved in the Middle East, would you say, on balance, that there's something particularly unique about the Middle East, or is it simply the dynamics that we experience elsewhere playing out in a particular region? I guess what I'm hinting at there is there are particular states here, Israel, Iran, others, that have historic legacy dynamics that are, you know, deeply entrenched in conflict. But that can be the case anywhere. Do you think there's something specific here that we need to pay attention to that would help people who are not as familiar with the dynamics in the Middle East to understand?
So I see that what is going on in a region, but including in the Middle East, from the lenses and from the angle of my background and my knowledge. But it's quite interesting to see the historical dynamic of relations of countries in the nuclear field. And here in particular, I would like to refer to Israel-Iran history of nuclear relations, because today there is no dialogue at all between those two countries, which is unfortunate. But in the past, those countries had joint cooperation in the nuclear field, including in the areas like uranium enrichment. It sounds like absolutely impossible today, but it was the case in the 70s, including, as I mentioned, on uranium enrichment. There was a project on missile, nuclear-capable missile. So, I mean, it's quite interesting how the relations evolved since then. And, of course, we should keep this in mind when we are trying to assess the nuclear politics, nuclear dynamic in the region nowadays, and what is behind the policy of some countries vis-a-vis Iran or vis-a-vis Israel or vis-a-vis other countries.
So on that particular issue, we're speaking the day after Presidents Biden and Putin met in Geneva. Do you have any sense of hope arising from yesterday's meeting and the possibility for cooperation between these two states in a way that previously we've seen tensions around?
Unfortunately, this is not the priority in the Russia-US agenda nowadays, and I did not hear even a mentioning of this issue either in the press conference of President Putin or in the press conference of President Biden after their meeting. My hope that gradually the relations between two countries would improve, and it will create additional opportunities for cooperation on this issue as well. But I think, first of all, there should be a decision in Washington by this administration, what would be their approach with regard to this zone, because I personally have not yet heard that. Having said that, I should notice that while we are speaking, Russia and US continue cooperation in Vienna in their joint attempt with a number of other countries, including Iran, to restore the JCPOA. So it does not mean that there is no any cooperation nowadays at all. The good news that for me, that the Biden administration announced its intention to return to the so-called Iran nuclear deal. And I think it could also be a good basis for further cooperation in the region if we succeed in this particular case, but still a lot of work to be done to finalize negotiations in Vienna.
What kind of suggestions would you offer in terms of, for example, the format that you've mentioned that you believe would be ideal to be able to do these kind of things?
We do need a regular dialogue, and Paul referred in his remarks that there was a quite active process about 10 years ago, I mean, in Geneva and other Swiss nice places. I do think that we should recreate something similar. It could be formal, it could be informal, it could be under UN umbrella. And we do have a regular conference. But what is critically important, universal participation of the countries of the region. Second, to have it a regular. And probably third priority, the expectations should be realistic from those meetings. If we would accept those three principles, I think it can help. And the role of external actors, including NPT depositories, Russia, US, UK, is really important. And if we have a unified position, I do think it could help, but with no interest from all major countries of the region, I don't see any real chance to progress.
On that point, Anton, we've seen before the pandemic, we saw the conferences happening in New York, or at least the first one, on a zone which did not include the Americans and the Israelis, but did include the Russians and the Brits and a number of other important countries, both inside and outside the region. Do you think that was a sign of significant hope, or was it almost valueless because the Israelis and the Americans were not there?
It's a good question, and I think each of the experts could answer in his or her own way. Either the glass is half full or half empty, which means that I think it's good that this process was launched, but to have it as a stable, regular, and efficient process, we do need all major stakeholders from the region and from outside of the region, which means that I would personally very much interested to see Israelis and Americans at the next conference when it takes place in person. I don't think that we should organize it in the virtual format, because this is exactly the kind of conference where in-person communication is really important. And while virtual conference and meetings could contribute a lot on other issues, I am not sure that we should apply this format, a virtual format, for this particular conference.
It's slightly different to the topics that we've asked on. It's more of a personal level. As you, a few questions ago, you touched on how your own interest stemmed and began in this field of nuclear security and non-proliferation. And some of our younger audiences encourage us to ask some of our interviewees about what kind of advice they might offer to someone who's interested in breaking into this field, especially as a young person, so that they might be able to gain some experience and enter some careers.
Oh, good question. I do like to see more and more young faces in our area. I still think not enough, but the dynamic, at least how I see that, including the Russia, I like it a lot. Second, I think this is the area where people out of the government, scholars, and researchers could contribute with their ideas, with their creative suggestions, with their proposals. And one of the example, this is a real story. It was about more than 10 years ago. Probably it was early winter of 2009. And I was just walking on the street with a son who was just born. He was, of course, in the pram. Just a few months old, and it was a good opportunity when he was sleeping just to think what could be done. And I remember there were a lot of snow around, and one of the idea came to my mind that it could be useful to establish a Moscow-based platform where we can bring a diverse group of governmental and non-governmental experts to discuss those pressing nuclear challenges which we face. And as a result of this idea, the Moscow Non-Proliferation Conference was established, and the first one took place in 2010, and the fifth and the most recent one took place in November 2019. So that idea evolved in a big one of a major world non-proliferation gatherings where we have Israelis, Iranians, Emiratis, Saudis, where we have people from Seoul and Pyongyang, from Washington, Beijing, and Moscow. So about 300 people. And I'm very optimistic that the next conference, which will take place next year from April 7 to April 9, despite of those challenges which we face because of COVID-19, will bring again a very diverse, very professional group of officials and scholars and researchers, which will have a good chance to share their ideas, their proposals with governmental officials. I'm sure that my other foreign colleagues have other examples how they could contribute. And by the way, Tom Neff's idea of so-called megatons to megawatts program is just one of them. When a scholar, an intellectual could create a huge project of non-proliferation importance.
So I have to come in there because I personally feel that the non-proliferation conference alone is an incredible contribution that you've made, Anton, to the international community. And if you had achieved nothing else in your career than putting that together, it would be something to feel incredibly proud of. What we haven't covered is that Anton also runs regular dialogues with North Korea, one of the very few people outside of North Korea that has such amazing access. And Anton, you are an inspiration to any young person that chooses to get into this field. So thank you from the bottom of my heart for that contribution. It's extraordinary.
Thank you, Paul.
No, a pleasure. We'll have to wrap it up there. But Anton, thank you so much for talking with us about the Middle East and the challenges.
Thank you, Paul, for inviting. Thank you, Anahita, for your questions.
Thank you.
It was my great pleasure to be with you.
Thank you so much. Thank you to everybody listening for tuning in for another episode of In the Zone. And thank you to Anton for joining us this week. Just as a quick reminder that you can find us on all of our social media platforms under the handle WMD3ME, and that you can tune into our bi-weekly episodes on our Spotify, SoundCloud, and YouTube. See you for the next episode.